Well, good morning.
We're so excited to be here on Easter Resurrection Sunday.
Amen. We're so wonderful to be here with you. Have a happy Easter, a Resurrection Day celebration of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And what he is going to do for us today is unveil some very important truths in regards to what we're celebrating here today in Jesus' name.
Amen. Praise God. Well, Pastor Wayne, this morning we're doing a tag team.
Okay.
Okay? We'll so I'm the two pieces of bread, and Pastor Wayne's the meat. So you're going to get a full course Resurrection Sunday dinner.
Right
here in the Word.
So you have to get the first slice now, and then a second slice after I'm done.
Right.
Doughy.
Right. Pillsbury dough girl.
All right,
amen. Praise God. And Father, we also pray over this offering this morning.
Amen.
We just give God all the glory, all the praise. We pray every one of the faithful givers.
Yes.
You're paying your tithes, making your offerings, not for us, not for a church, but Father, in obedience to the word of God, you bless the obedience of the givers in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. All right, so I'm going to begin, and before I do this, I just want to take a moment to really just praise God. This weekend, we received an incredible testimony of a member of the church totally healed of cancer. So if God did that for you, the resurrection life, the Zoe life, he can do that for you, no matter what you're standing in faith, believe in God for. Stay in the Word, stay encouraged, and know God is on your side. Amen? All right, so I want to begin by sharing the account of Wilfred Grenfell. He was a famous missionary doctor to Labrador. Dr. Grenfell had many hair-raising adventures, but one is told more than any of the stories that were ever told about him or he himself told. On one Easter Sunday in 1908, he received an urgent call to come and treat a gravely ill young man in a village 60 miles away. 60 miles away. Keep that in mind. He harnessed his dog team. He set out for the village as quickly as possible. By 1908, he couldn't fly there by Meta helicopter, all right? There was nobody to drive him. He takes his dogs and the sled, and he heads out 60 miles away to this village. It was the time of the spring thaw, but to save time, he decided to risk crossing the ice on the bay instead of winding around this rugged road getting to the village. It was an unwise decision, for the ice was breaking and the ice was shifting, and Grenfell and his dog suddenly plunged into this icy water. He managed to pull himself and only three of his dogs onto a chunk of ice, but the wind was so strong, so bitterly cold, it was driving the ice further and further out to sea. So to avoid freezing to death, he killed his three dogs. I mean, sad, but this is what happened in order to save his life. He killed his three dogs and wrapped himself in the bloody skins. There he was shivering through the whole night long. The following morning, he was actually near death. But his friends, they risked their lives maneuvering between the surging ice chunks to rescue this man. The story of his courage spread widely, leading many others to come to serve with him in Labrador. Even so, listen to this now, even so, it was on Good Friday that we were wrapped in the righteousness of the Lamb who was slain for our salvation, and it was on Easter Sunday that we were rescued from a cold death by the sudden appearance of the risen Lord. What an incredible parallel. So here we are on Sunday, March 31st, 2024. Many call it Easter Sunday. We celebrate it, and it should be called by many Resurrection Sunday, the day that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ rose from the dead. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Let's stop right there. Pastor Wayne shall now feed you in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. Glory to God. If you'll turn to John chapter 12 in your Bible, John chapter 12, we're going to talk about a grain of wheat, a grain of wheat, and what that means to us as a child of God. John chapter 12, verse 20. And there were certain Greeks among them, amongst the people that came to hear Jesus Christ, there were certain Greeks among them that came up to worship at the feast. These same Greeks came before Philip, which was a Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, "Sir, we would like to see Jesus." And Philip cometh and telleth Andrew, and Andrew also tells, and Philip tell Jesus what took place. When Jesus heard what they had to say, that these Greeks wanted to talk to him and meet him personally, Jesus answered them, saying, "The hour is come that the Son of Man should be glorified." What they said triggered something inside of Jesus. He was able to understand something at that point, that something was working up to a certain point, and now he knew the time had come. The time had come. When you look at the scriptures and you look at what the scriptures have to say, you will find that through the scriptures are telling you that there are certain intervals or time sequences that must be met. And when you finally reach that point in time, then things change. All right? The Bible refers to it as appointed time or in the fullness of time. So time builds to a certain fullness of time, and then what was prophesied begins to take place. When Jesus heard what Philip and Andrew said, he knew that when Gentiles desired to hear the truth of God, it was a sign of the great harvest that was about to come. So he taught his disciples, at that point, he taught his disciples a profound parable. In your Bible, it's only a paragraph long, but it's a profound parable. John chapter 12, verse 24. "Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit." So a corn of wheat is a grain. It's one of the little small little grains of wheat that's on a wheat stalk. One of those little grains you can plant in the ground, and it will produce an entire brand new wheat stalk covered with hundreds and hundreds of wheat grain on that one stalk. Note, a grain of wheat is the seed that when planted in the earth itself will protect from any harm of the elements. The seed no longer is of any use for food. It's dead. But when the rain comes and the waters the earth that the seed is buried in, a miracle happens. I call it a miracle, but it's actually just a plain, simple truth of how the cycles of life work. The seed sprouts new life. A dead seed comes back to life. The once dead seed now develops a stalk with an ear of hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of wheat seeds in that stalk. Jesus was using a naturally known process to establish and describe what he would have to do. He was going to be the wheat seed. Now, when he described this to his disciples, not all of them were farmers, no. Some were tax collectors, some were fishermen. But they all understood one thing. This is how you get wheat. This is how you get flour to make bread. You have to have wheat seeds. So What you do is you plant one seed, and they knew that that seed would develop an entire stalk filled with wheat seed. This is the way it worked. This was not a hidden perspective that nobody understood. They all understood it. Jesus was comparing himself to a wheat seed. Jesus is using a naturally known process to describe what he would have to do. When wheat grows, it comes to a point in the development where it is fully developed and grown, and the stalk and the ear on the stalk is filled with ripe, beautiful wheat seed. At that point, the wheat has to be cut off. It has to be cut off. The harvesters would go into the field, grab a whole bunch of stalk, and with the sickle, cut it off from the earth. They would cut the wheat seed off from the earth. Now, the earth all this time has been the source of life to the wheat. But now, the source of life to the wheat is being cut off. It's being cut off. What's interesting about this is that Daniel, the prophet Daniel, actually spoke about the Messiah being cut off. Daniel himself, understanding how wheat grows, would realize he, the Messiah, would be cut off from the earth. Daniel chapter 9, verse 26. And after 62 weeks, after 62 weeks, the Living Bible tells me that amounts to 434 years. So from the time that Daniel spoke these prophecies, it would be 434 years when they would come true. After 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off. He'll be cut off. Just like when the time has come for wheat, it must be cut off from the earth, Jesus knew his time had come for him to be cut off from the earth. Now, statement. When Jesus died on the cross, his disciples, like wheat, had to take his body and plant it in the earth. They planted him in a tomb nearby the cross. They planted him in a tomb. 3 days later, his resurrected, brand new life arose up from the grave. Like wheat, it was dead. The Lord's body was dead. But now it had a resurrected life. He came back to life. How could something that's dead come back to life? It got new life. And where did the new life come from? In this case, rather than the new life coming from the earth, remember, he was cut off from the earth. Where did this life come from? It came from God himself. This is not natural human life. This is celestial, eternal life from God. Jesus came back to life, but now nothing could ever kill him ever again. Why? Because his life was not based upon what the earth could give him. His life is now based upon what God himself had given him. 50 days later, after the maturity of the full awareness of what Jesus had accomplished, what I'm saying there is this. When Jesus rose from the dead, he appeared to the disciples numerous times. It's almost like that they still, no matter how many times he appeared to them, they just could not get it that he rose from the dead. They just couldn't get it. They didn't couldn't grab a hold of it. So what we find is it took some time. It actually took 40 days of appearing, constantly reassuring. No, I came back to life. Touch me, feel me. Give me something to eat, I'll show you. I came back to life. We read this in the Gospels. So, what was that waiting period for? Well, you'll see in a minute here, it was for many reasons. But the main reason is that the disciples themselves, who would then take the ball, so to speak, and begin to roll it into life and change the people around them and the whole world to believe in the Messiah, Jesus Christ. But they had to first get it themselves. Jesus knew they could never really grasp a hold of this until a very special day in the future, known as Pentecost. And there at Pentecost, everything changed. What happened 50 days later? On Pentecost, the celebration of wheat harvest. Pentecost is known as the celebration of the wheat harvest in Judea. They would all get together and everybody would get excited and they have a great big feast and they'd be so happy because now it was the wheat harvest. We were now going to gather the wheat harvest that they'd waited so long. And this harvest meant a lot to them. Why? Because this way they would realize they're not going to starve to death. So they would celebrate the wheat harvest known as Pentecost. What happened on Pentecost? Why was that so important? What changed everything on Pentecost? Well, on Pentecost, Peter, like the other disciples, now baptized in the Holy Spirit, went down out of the upper room into the streets, and who was there? All these Jewish people from all the different provinces of all the known world came to Jerusalem to worship God and to sacrifice at the altar of the Lord in Jesus' name. So, what happened? At that point, Peter spoke to these people, and 3,000 people received Christ in one day. 3,000 people received Christ in one day. What we find is that 3,000 people entered the kingdom of God on Pentecost. Now, in comparison, listen, when the entire Jewish nation was now celebrating a great harvest of wheat here on this earth, the Heavenly Father was celebrating a great harvest of souls into the kingdom of God. Now, I find this remarkable because what happened is this. This has been on the heart of the Father God all along, to finally win back his created being that he made in the image and likeness of himself, to win him back away from Satan and get his children back so he owns and has a part in his life, their life again. So as the world was celebrating the harvest of wheat, the Heavenly Father was celebrating a harvest of souls in the kingdom of God. The harvest of souls has been going on, harvesting of souls has been going on for the last 2,000 years. What's interesting is I got a paper the other day from CFAN, Christ for All Nations. And CFAN states in the year 2023, 3,526,854 souls received into the kingdom of God. In the year 2023. Now, Jesus went on to say some very strong, important factors here. While all this was taking place here in John chapter 12, and because these Greeks wanted to see him, he not only spoke this parable about the wheat, but then he went on to say some very spine-tingling words. This is in relationship to people who truly believe in Christ. truly are believers now. Verse 25, John chapter 12, verse 25. He that loveth his life shall lose it. In other words, if you love your natural world life, that's all you care about is your natural life. If you love that so much, you'll actually end up losing your life. And he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. In other words, he's basically showing the focus of where our heart should really be. Is it based upon the natural things of life, or is it based upon the spiritual things of life? Because if it's based on the spiritual things, I don't care about anything in the natural. I hate the whole perspective of being even part of the natural world. My body might be natural, but I'm not. I'm a born-again believer in Christ. Verse 26, if any man serve me. Now, if we're truly believers in Christ Jesus, we serve the Lord. He's the master, and we serve the Lord. If any man serve me, let him follow me. In other words, follow the Lord's example. Follow the Lord's example. What did he do? He sacrificed himself for us. This is what we tend to want to ignore or not really want to be a part of. Sacrifice. I mean, I have to sacrifice part of my own life for other people? Well, that's what it takes. It takes some your own efforts and desire out of your own self to preach the gospel to other people. Why? Because they don't know it. Today, especially in society, there are millions of people that are walking right by every day, and they are oblivious. They have a perception of the second coming that people have told them, and they don't believe any of it, all right? Well, what's really the problem here? They don't have enough intellectual information? No, the problem is they're lost. Their soul is lost. They need to know that they have a Savior, Jesus Christ, who has saved them from their sin. They need to know that there's a way out. This is what we need to tell them. They don't need intellectual information. They need to know that the Savior, Jesus Christ, came to save them from damnation because of their sinful nature. They need to realize there's a way out. You need to receive Christ as your Savior. He's the one who paid the price. He paid the price. If any man serve me, let him follow me or follow my example. Where I am, there shall also my servant be. Where I am, there shall also shall my servant be. So if the Lord is at the right hand of the Father in heaven right now, where I am, where he is, so shall my servant be. In other words, you want to be at the right hand with the Heavenly Father with the Lord Jesus Christ? Well, then you have to what? You have to follow the Lord's example. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. This is a very, very important factor. Here the Lord is teaching his disciples. You have to honor the Lord. You have to honor Jesus Christ by doing and following him, his example in life. What did he do? Does that mean you had to be someone nail you to a cross? I'm not saying these kind of things. I'm just simply saying it takes a certain amount of effort on each one of our part to do our part in society to help people to understand and know the truth. If they still want to go to hell, that's their privilege. But if they understood the truth, and that's where the real problem is, many of them think they know the truth. They have no clue whatsoever what they're doing. We need to tell them the truth. We need to show the example that Christ shows, an example of love and compassion. We need to lay hands on the sick and see them recover. We need to speak the word of God over circumstances and situations and show them what God's holy power and might can do in every given situation. Be an example. Like Jesus was an example, be an example to the world around us. As we celebrate Pastor Mary's going to put the second piece of the bread on for the sandwich. As we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we must ask ourselves, what have I done? What have I done in the past year to win soul for Christ? Because he has done everything he could do to make it happen. That's the real question here. What can we do? What can we do together? What can we do individually? What can I do every day while I'm out going to work or going to school or whatever I'm doing or going shopping? What can I do? Many times we don't really know exactly. We can have a somewhat of a plan, but we don't really know exactly what we're going to do. But if you pray ahead of time and ask God, Lord, is there something I can do? I want to be a demonstration of God's anointing and power to help people who really need your help. And that's what we need to do. Remember this on Easter Sunday and what it's really all about. Praise the Lord. Pastor Maria.
Amen. Praise God. Well, I want to also encourage you, go grab your communion elements, because at the end here, we're going to celebrate communion together.
Amen.
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 So I will hand these to you, Pastor Wayne. You know, we, as this ministry is, John 3:16 Christian ministry, is based on the scripture, John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. When you look at that in light of what Pastor Wayne just preached, God actually blessed us with a seed. Did you ever think of that, Pastor Wayne?
Yeah.
All right? Imagine the love the Father has for humanity, that he would ask his only son, Jesus, to come to planet Earth to redeem us from eternal damnation, eternal separation from the Father. That's the Father's love for humanity. Imagine while we were still sinners, separated from God, Jesus Christ died for us, giving us this free gift of eternal salvation. Jesus, in obedience to the Father's heart, he became human. He took our place. He died on the cross. He paid the penalty for our sin, and he bridged the gap that was between Father God and humanity.
Glory to God.
How amazing, from the foundation of the world, Father God has had a plan and purpose for each and every one of our lives. It's really what Pastor Wayne just said. There's something every one of us can do to fulfill the call of God, or that great commission that God commissions every child of God to fulfill. None of us are here by accident. None of us have been placed in this dispensation, this time frame.
Yeah. Yeah.
None of us are here by accident. God gave us the gift of the Holy Spirit, and he empowered us that no matter what's transpiring in this world system, which the days are growing darker and darker, each and every day you hear something different, that you're standing there with your mouth open going like, what next? This Thursday night, I'm going to share a message that I just believe is going to open every one of our eyes to really understand better why we're here at this point in time. None of us are here by accident. All we have to do is receive this free gift of life, eternal life. Someone once said, the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which transformed Peter's fear into courage and James' doubt into faith, is the resurrected life.
Mm.
It was the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which changed the Sabbath into Sunday and the Jewish remnant into the Christian church. It was the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which changed Saul the Pharisee into Paul the Apostle, turning his persecution into preaching. And perhaps the transformation of the disciples of Jesus Christ was the greatest evidence of the resurrection of all. Mm. Just like the grain of wheat, as Pastor Wayne shared, falling into the ground, transformation of old life into new life.
Glory to God.
In Christ Jesus.
Glory to God.
We are now redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
There's this incredible story that's told about a Sunday school teacher. She asked the children in the class to bring in those little plastic eggs that we see in all the stores around this time of the year. And she said, I want each one of you to fill the egg with something that symbolizes the meaning of the resurrection. So the day came, the teacher took each child's egg in turn, opening the egg and making a point of amplifying the meaning that the child's heart placed into that egg. One child had this tiny little flower, and the teacher spoke of the new life that springs forth at Easter. Another egg contained a crayon picture of Christ, and the teacher spoke of that. Another had a small nail, and the point was made about the nails of the cross. Another had a round pebble that represented the stone that guarded the tomb. But the teacher was dumbfounded when he opened the egg of Brian, a 7-year-old with a learning disability, and found nothing in the egg. Nothing was there. But not to worry, Brian himself spoke up and he announced, "It's full of the emptiness, just like the tomb of Jesus." It was the greatest lesson of all. When we look on the lives of the people around us, so many of these people are empty inside. They're like walking zombies, right? They're searching. They're trying to fill the voids with everything that you could imagine. And nothing is ever going to fill that emptiness, fill that void, except life in Christ. The empty tomb only points to the living God.
Amen.
And it is only the love of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the love that's only going to fill that void. Jesus stands at the door of every heart and he knocks. Again, never pushy, never saying you must accept me. He just stands and knocks, giving us the invitation to open up our heart, open up our life, and receive him as our personal Lord and Savior.
Yes, amen.
And what happens when we do? There is an excitement, there is a joy. No matter what's taking place around you, it's like it just becomes invisible because you become so one with Christ, you'll never regret that decision ever again. Every one of us who have accepted Christ can testify to this fact.
Yes.
So, today's your day. He's here. You can mark this day down, Resurrection Sunday 2024. Is the day I opened up my life, opened up my heart. It doesn't matter if you're religious. You may be going to church every Sunday. You may even have a Bible, but you don't know him as your personal Lord and Savior. Today's your day. All you have to do is pray this prayer with me and Pastor Wayne and accept Jesus and say, "I totally yield to you. I submit to you."
Yes.
My life, my hopes, my dreams. Yeah, but I want to still do this, and I want to get this done in my life, and I want to have that, and I want to acquire. Stop thinking that way. Because as you seek first the kingdom of God, all those other things, God will add to you, including the desires of your heart. Put him first. He put us first.
Yes, he did.
He laid down his life
yes,
for us. And as Pastor Wayne said, he inherited kingship. He's now the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, our soon coming King.
Amen.
Who can come any day to take the church out. Don't be left behind.
Glory
to go
to
through
God.
That tribulation period, 7 years of hell on earth. Make the decision today as we pray this prayer with you this morning.
Yes, Lord. Father, we thank you. Who's ever out there who has never received Christ as your Savior, if you're watching this Easter service and you can't really say for sure that when you die, you'd know you're going to be in heaven, then make it sure today. Let that surety come from this prayer as you commit yourself to Jesus Christ, the Savior. Say this with us. Say out loud. Say, "Heavenly Father,
Heavenly Father,
I believe that Jesus is the Christ,
that Jesus is the Christ,
the Son of the living God,
the Son of the living God.
He died for me.
He died for me.
Went to hell in my place.
Went to hell in my place.
He arose from the dead.
He arose from the dead.
And ascended into heaven.
And ascended into heaven.
Lord, I ask you this day.
Lord, I ask you this day.
Please forgive me.
Please forgive
me. Of all my past wrong.
Of all my past wrong.
I repent of it all.
I repent of it all.
I turn and receive.
I turn and receive.
Your free gift of salvation.
Your free gift of salvation.
And I make you my Lord.
And I make you my Lord.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Glory to God. If you prayed that prayer, that means you have a right to eternity with Christ.
Amen.
In fact, God was so anxious to get you into the heaven, he's already, Colossians 1:13 says, he's already translated you out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear Son.
Praise God.
That's how much he wanted you to be a part of all of us in the kingdom. We congratulate you this day on Easter Sunday, 2024, you receive Christ Jesus because he was knocking on your door for you to open it up to him. And you opened and received eternal salvation.
Praise God. Yes.
Praise God.
Welcome to the family of God.
Amen.
Call us. Share that good news. We've got a gift for you. And we're just excited to have you part of this family. The family of God. Universal family of God.
Yes.
But especially John 3:16.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Praise God. Well, we're now going to celebrate communion.
We're going to celebrate communion now. And if you have your cracker and juice ready, it'd be good. What's so important about this is the fact that on that fateful night, when Jesus paid the price, prior to him paying the price, that is, he had supper with his disciples. And there he took bread and he broke it and he gave it, passed it around to each one of his disciples. Here, take, eat. This is my body. He was giving them an analogy, okay? This is my body. My physical body, he says, is going to be broken. It's going to be just totally beat and tortured and mutilated. And I do this for you. And eat this bread in remembrance of what I did for you. Now, did Jesus, was he abused this way physically just for no good reason? No, what he did is by doing it, he took your right. He paid for your right, that is, to be totally healed and live a healthy and whole life because he paid the price for physical health and wholeness in your body. So when we eat this bread, we remember what the Lord has done for us. Because we will never forget what he did so we would not have to suffer anymore physically, mentally, emotionally on this earth anymore. It's been paid by the redemption of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's eat the bread. Now after supper, he took bread and took the cup, that is, and he said, look, this is the cup of my blood. When you drink of it, you drink of the New Testament that I'm cutting with you this very day. What Jesus was saying was that you have grown up, you Jewish guys have all grown up with a covenant that Abraham had with my father. But I'm cutting a new covenant with you because I'm going to keep this covenant. You couldn't keep the covenant with Abraham. You failed miserably over all these thousands of years. But because I'm keeping the covenant, you're going to reap the benefit of the covenant that I cut with you this night. In Jesus' name. So, Lord, we drink this cup in remembrance of you, remembering that the covenant price that you paid was paid forever. It will never run dry. The blood will always speak out. Your blood, Lord, will always speak out, guaranteeing our eternal salvation in the hereafter with our Savior and Lord forever and ever. And we are so grateful. We drink of this in remembrance of you, Lord. Amen. Let's drink. Praise you, Lord. Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity to receive of the covenant elements this day. And we receive the rights and privileges that come with children of God. Amen. And the right to be children of God. Lord, we thank you for what you have done. Resurrection Sunday is very important to each and every one of us. And today, even more, we stand before you and we ask you, Lord, to help us to be good agents of omnipotent power, to deliver to the people that we come in contact with each and every day, that we will not be inhibited in any way, that Satan will not inhibit us, but will be eager to pray and to minister the anointing to each and every person that you bring in our path. Amen. And we thank you for that, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 Praise the Lord.
Pastor Wayne, as you were praying that, I just saw this picture of fire. And I just believe the Holy Spirit is wanting us to explode with the power that's within us.
I agree.
So before we close, I want you just to put your hand right on your belly. It says the river of life flows forth. So, Father, we just thank you for a fresh baptism of the fire of God over every one of the children of God that are watching and partaking of this service, Father. We just thank you. Ignite us, O God.
Yes.
As Isaiah said, here I am, Father, use me. Here I am, Lord, use me. Here I am, Holy Spirit, use me.
Yes.
Fire, like putting new logs on a burning fire. It's igniting. There's something happening inside of you. It's like a joy. There's a peace. There's an expectancy that God's opening doors that no man can open for you to begin opening up your mouth wide, and he will fill it with the right words at the right time, led by the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Holy Ghost in operation in your life like never before. Ignited resurrection
in Jesus' name.
Fire in the name of Jesus.
And glory to God.
Amen.
Amen.
Glory to God.
Amen. Wow, it's been great to celebrate the Lord today with you all. We know that the Lord is doing great and mighty things in you because he's doing great and mighty things in us here in this ministry. And so praise the Lord for what God is doing in your life as you grow and to develop and continue to move in the things of God. Walk with the King. Be a blessing to someone that God brings in your path.
Amen.
And we will see you on Sunday, that is on Thursday, because God has got another wonderful word that you need to hear, very relevant to the times that we're living in.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Praise the Lord.
God.